Greetings, I'm Dave, welcome to my YouTube channel, and today's video is going to be a subject of how two-stroke modelling software works. I'm going to give you a reasonably as brief as I can rundown of how the software works, what goes into it, basically how it models the outputs of the engine, power, torque, and including that, how we get a calculated expansion chamber from the model using some of these parameters. And then once we've done the basics of how the software works and if you intend using it, otherwise we can take some of these components in here and we can just do a one-way calculation for a suitable expansion chamber for any particular engine. And so in the next video, what we'll do is take some of this stuff and feed it in and design ourselves an expansion chamber. Very exciting. Now, even if you don't intend on building a expansion chamber or doing other mods to your engine anytime soon, there's nothing like practice, because making or actually building, physically building an expansion chamber, there is quite a bit of manual work to it, cutting, fabrication, welding, etc., and a lot to do. So you don't want to be making mistakes in doing all of your calculations when you actually get to the job of doing it on your first pipe and waste all that time and effort, or even use a modelling software for the purpose to do that whilst understanding what's actually going on inside it, because it's going to ask you a lot of questions about things you're going to have to enter into the software. And that is one thing about the software I'm going to cover as well in this video. So to begin with, in the software, the first part of the modelling software is we have to get the physical dimensions of the engine. And this is as important as any part of it, because if you are inaccurate in making all of these measurements, everything else is going to be based on the accuracy of these measurements. So you have to measure them all accurately, and with this modeling software, if you're going to model the output, you have to measure all of the values. And these values that I've put in here are the main ones, but by no means are they the entire list, as I said down here. Bore, stroke, conrod length, deck height, that is the height if the piston doesn't come quite to the top of the barrel, because we're measuring millimetres from the top of the barrel down to our ports. We need crankcase volumes at top and bottom dead centre. We need the heights of the ports, the width of the ports. There is a process around measuring the width of the port. We'll get to that, because we have to do that for the expansion chamber calculations. Combustion chamber volume, squish, port ducts, they're the length of tubing effectively from the inlet or outlet of each of the ports, and the ports timings, when they open, when they close, and port angles, and essentially all of the physical characteristics of the engine that we put in. And those are actually used as our dimensions, our working dimensions for the next part of it, which is calculating the operating parameters. And so we take all of these physical attributes of the engine and we make some various calculations. Now, with these calculations, we've also got a couple of input variables that we have to input for the model, which is the type of fuel we're using, the fuel mixtures, the exhaust air coolant temperatures, ignition timing, even throttle positions, carby size, etc., all of these other things, but that goes into here. But these are the various things that can be variable within the engine that we also plug into it. We have to tell it basically what our environment is and what we're feeding into it in the way of fuels, etc. Then we take some of these fairly straightforward calculations. Now, these calculations are, these ones at the top are mostly trigonometry calculations, calculating the dimensions of how fast or how far the piston is moving for crankshaft degrees, etc., so that we get our means of timing as well. These ones are fairly straightforward calculations that are taken that give us some more information, such as the geometric swept, that's the entire swept volume, the trapped cylinder volume, which is when the ports, the exhaust ports are actually closed and the piston continues on. We've got trapped compression and the compression ratios of both in those in the cylinder, compression ratio of the crankcase as well. Now, this important one is the port and the blowdown time areas. So the time area is a calculation of how much time a particular port or aperture is open for and the area of size. So to give you an analogy of that, if you had a mains water pipe and you've got a very large tap on it and you've got a very small tap on it, if you filled up a container from the large tap, you should turn it on for a short period, then turn it off enough to fill up a certain volume. To fill up the same volume from a small tap, you'd have to turn it on for a lot longer before you turn it off. So essentially that's what this is telling us. The ports are open for a certain period of time depending on what the area or size of them is, and that thus it gets how much volume of gas can flow through there, in addition to its effective pressures, which is the BMEP. That's more or less the main one. Then we have other figures like with our fuel inputs here, our brake-specific fuel consumption. Then we have our FMEP, which is our frictional mean effective pressure. So what that is that's the pressure loss required to actually mechanically turn the engine over. So all the bearings and pistons and rings and whatever, everything that causes a drag on the engine, that's the amount of pressure we need to overcome it. This is the pumping mean effective pressure. That's the pumping values in the cylinder and the process of the gas going through, piston going up and down, etc. So our indicated mean effective pressure will then be the actual pressures inside our crankcase and our cylinder, etc., that will give us basically our indicated power. Now we have to take those values. As I said, these are fairly more straightforward calculations, but these ones are complex calculations, and that's basically what I call models. Now these are the ones that you can actually get yourself, and you can do individual calculations, you can do specific time area targets and time areas calculations alone, but these ones that actually model the heat from combustion, the combustion, the time of the combustion, how much heat's lost, how much energy is produced, the effectiveness of the scavenging efficiency, etc., and the squish in relationship to what happens when combustion occurs based on how much squish, you know, whatever the physical dimensions are. And from all of that, we get a calculated predicted power output. Basically, it's a matter of, once we know how much pressure we've got at the top of our piston, all of that taken into account, and we know the length of our crank and our conrod and our crank pin from centre, we can figure out the leverage, so we can figure out the torque, and then we know the RPM, and thus we can figure out the power. So that's essentially what the software does. It's a very basic explanation. I'm trying to keep it down. We've got 6 minutes already through that. So it takes some of those calculations and plugs it into calculating the expansion chamber. And from the expansion chamber, we know that we're using the chamber, the various sizes and dimensions and angles in the chamber, to change the effective characteristics of the sonic compression and expansion waves that are returning for the scavenging and for the port plugging. And we plug those back in. We can make changes to the expansion chamber and plug those values back in to see how it will affect these pressures. And then we can put that through, and then we can get another calculated output. So we can get a bit of a feedback loop from there. Likewise with port timings, blowdown and port time areas, we can do similar sorts of modifications within the software as we can do with the expansion chamber to then finally get a calculated power output. And then we can match our power output from one change to another. As to prices of software, it ranges wildly. And I will say now that pretty much every software that's been written with two-stroke modelling software is almost universally derived from the works of Professor Gordon Blair, who put out two editions of his works in books in 1990, 1996, 97. Now in the 1990 version, he put all of his source code in the back of the book for all of this stuff, all the equations, and you can find it and go through it all. And pretty much everybody took all of his calculations and wrote softwares for it for commercial purposes. You will see very much familiarity in all of the softwares with a lot of this stuff because it's all based around Gordon Blair's works, and then some of the softwares, some of them maybe the more expensive softwares, have sort of gone off on their own tangents a little bit with some of the characteristics, but you know, it's hard to know with those because they're proprietary, they're not published like Gordon Blair's works were. So if something is not peer reviewed, it's hard to tell whether they've just used cut and dried methods or, you know, dynamometers and cause and effect without actually scientifically modelling it, such as Gordon Blair did. So I can't give you any kind of opinions on which one is better or which one isn't in that respect. And I think that will do it for today. So as I said, the next one, we're going to take which one of these, some of these values, which are simple enough to measure. We're going to give you some of these calculations you need, only the bare minimum that we need to actually do the calculation for an expansion chamber for that purpose. So that'll be the next video, and that will do it for today. And as I said, even if you don't want to build a pipe now, it won't take long to go through, and then you can have a couple of practice shots before you actually put torch to metal, and because you know building one is a lot of effort and time if you're going to do it well. And that will do it for today. And so be sure to subscribe and catch up on those if you haven't yet. And if you do, thanks very much. I appreciate that. And hopefully we'll see you in the next video. Bye for now.